Well, good morning, church. How are we today? Oh, I almost have your attention. Good morning, church. How are we today? All right, that's better. I want to invite you to stand with me as we open in worship and praise to our Lord. I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. Oh, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death's lie. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony, yeah. Oh, yeah. Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father, our God. We'll finish what he started. Yes, our God will finish what he started. This is my testimony from death's life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Yeah. Ooh, yeah. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from death's life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Amen, amen. Good morning, church. Hey, it is so good to be with you this morning here at SCN. That song reflects our heart this morning as we want to proclaim the testimony and how God is in the business of rewriting our stories so that we can proclaim his goodness together. And so I'm so glad that you've joined us to be a part of sharing that testimony with one another today. I'm going to invite you to be seated for just a moment. I got a few things I want to share with you here today. If you are a guest worshiping with us, I want to welcome you and so glad that you've chosen to join us and worship here today. Hopefully you've been warmly greeted by our greeters greeters as you've come in today. There are also cards in the chairs around you. We encourage you to fill that out. Helps us to get to know you a little bit. You can put those in one of the black boxes at the rear of the sanctuary or give them to any of the greeters, and they'll get those cards where they need to go. We don't bombard you, but we definitely want to make a connection and make sure that we can follow up with you a little bit going forward. So if you could do that, that would be really helpful. If you are a regular attender, if you haven't done so already by now, we encourage you to check in online. We have lots of people that come between our two services, and so we might say hi to you and make a connection, and sometimes we might miss it in the movement of all the people. And so we want to make sure that we're following up and connecting and making sure nobody's missing, certainly too long. And so if you could do that, that certainly helps us make those connections on Sunday morning. And while you're on there, while you're on the app checking in, you can also take notice of the various activities through our action pages, as well as continue to give your tithes and offerings to the church. You can do that online or with the black boxes if you brought it in person together today. God is doing a lot in our church. We have a lot of ministry that happens in the life of our church, and it's in large part because you contribute by being a part in financially supporting the work of the church so that we can do those kinds of ministries, but also because you're serving, because you're plugging in and you're getting involved in what we do here in our church. And so we do have a few things. Just want to draw to your attention some things that are coming up. I want to make sure you're aware of those items. Next Sunday, immediately following this service, in rooms 22 and 23, just down the hall, we're going to have an informational meeting for our trip to Guatemala next summer, in the end of August. There is not a commitment at this point, but we would certainly, if you're even slightly interested in attending that, we're hoping for like 10 to 15 people probably to go on that trip next summer. But we need to kind of solidify that group and that team as we begin to plan and as a church support those who are going to represent our church in Guatemala next summer. And so if that's something that you are interested, even if you're not sure about this particular trip, but you might be interested in attending or participating in a international work and witness trip, we would encourage you to just come to this meeting because you'll get to hear a little bit about what it is and how it works. And whether it's this one or another one in the future, you'll have a little bit more information to know how to plug in and be involved with that. So next Sunday, right after second service, we'll be doing that. Also coming up next Monday on the 18th, we are hosting the FCASU Thanksgiving dinner. God has done some great things. We love our SU students. We love that God is connecting them with our church, and we love to make those continue to invest in them as they invest in their peers, and we continue to be the hands and feet of Christ, not just here in our church and what we do here, but also on campus. But we are hosting their Thanksgiving meal this year, and we are working to pull all those details together. But what I'm going to tell you this morning is you can't have a meal without food. All right? And so we have some food coming. Most of it is gluten-free. Close your ears, college students, right? Because I'm working right now to get you some good food, okay? But we have the gluten-free stuff taken care of. But what we don't have is all the other stuff. And so we definitely need you to help out. So right this morning, even while I'm talking, you can multitask. I know you're good people for that, right? So go ahead and go on. You can hit that QR code or in the check-in information page on the app. You can see some of the ways and foods and things that we're looking for. Let's provide a lot of foods because college kids know how to eat. And so we need everybody to kind of help out a little bit if you can. So if you do that even right now, that'll help Pastor Josh this week as he's trying to make plans and putting all the final details together for that event. Also, coming up this Tuesday, if you have children younger age, we're having a packing party on Tuesday evening at 6 o'clock for the Operation Christmas Child. As a church, you guys have done a great job taking boxes and filling boxes and bringing them back and participating in this great annual ministry. But our young people are going to have fun doing that together with family and parents and siblings, and we're going to be doing that this week on Tuesday. So great opportunity for you to participate in that ministry if you haven't done so already and wanted to put that on your radar. At this time, I'm going to invite you to stand, and we're going to draw your attention to the screen. We're going to look at our scripture verse for the month, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. Would you say this with me this morning? So, my dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always work enthusiastically for the Lord. For you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless. Amen. This morning we're going to celebrate and praise that God, knowing that nothing we ever do, including our worship, is ever useless. So let's worship the Lord this morning.
I search the world
it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Singing, I'm not afraid to show you my weakness or my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all, and you still call me friend. 'Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. Oh, there's not a place your mercy and grace won't find me again. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can. You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the only one who cares. You're the only one who cares. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. One more time. Lord, there's nothing. Lord, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You're worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Lord, you're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. us the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Lord, you're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, oh Jesus. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy, holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are. I think about the story of Joshua, and when he's talking to his people on his deathbed, and one of his last words to them was, "As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." And so as we sing this song, would we build our lives on him?
I will build my life upon your love. It is foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine.
For thee all the follies,
for thee all the fall
of sin I resign,
of sin I resign.
My gracious Redeemer,
my gracious Redeemer,
my Savior art thou,
my Savior art thou.
If ever,
if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
Let's pray together. Oh, my Jesus. My Jesus, I love you. Those are powerful words. Power, because there's power in the name of Jesus. But power also because we get to claim you as our own. My Jesus. My Jesus. I love you. Father God, this morning, Lord, that's our heart. Lord, that we would know you in such an intimate way, that we enjoy gathering and coming into your presence. We love being able to do that as we gather together as your people in a setting like this. Lord, we look forward to the gathering of your people to come and worship and bring a collective voice of praise and honor to you in your name. God, we are so grateful to be able to do that. We're so grateful to be able to, whatever the busyness and the chaos is going on all around us, that we can just take some pause in the middle of the week. We can take this time to bring our focus in to you. Because, God, we know that you have the answers, you have the presence, you have the hope, you have the encouragement, you have the blessing, God, that we are longing for, that we are needing, that we are desiring, Lord God, to be able to navigate all of the crazy that goes on around us. And God, we don't dare move forward without you. Father, we love being able to gather together in times like this and to corporately bring your praise and just lift it up to you. But we recognize that we don't have to come to church to pray. We don't have to come to church to know you and to see you. That God, you are in every element of our week. Lord, everywhere that we go, God, you are there. We don't always take notice of it, though. Sometimes we have blinders on. Sometimes there is obstacles that are preventing us be able to see past and to know what you're doing and where you're working and how you're moving. So, Father, there is a line in the second song there that we sang that praised the prayer that, God, you would open our eyes in wonder. Father, this morning, whether we are gathered together as your people or we are outgoing in the midst of the chaos that swirls around us, Lord God, I pray that you would open our eyes to see you. And not just to see you and say, oh yeah, that's nice. What's up, Jesus? You know, I'm so grateful that God, you long to have a relationship with us, that we can be casual with you and just say hi. But I'm also grateful, Lord God, for your wonder. God, I'm grateful for the fact that, God, you are in the business of making yourself known and that you're in the business of continuing to move and work in ways that when life seems like it's impossible, you just simply step back and say, yeah, that's nothing. I got this. So, God, would you open our eyes to wonder, to your presence, to your majesty. God, let us not miss out on what you're doing because we're too focused inward on ourselves, blinded by the biases that we have lived with and lived through, by the obstacles that others have placed around us that hinder us from being able to see you at work. Open our eyes to your wonder, Lord God. But Lord, I don't want us to just be able to see. I want us to be able to be actively engaged with you, to participate with you in that wonder. God, you have called us to be your hands and feet. You have given us opportunity to shine brightly with our testimony, with the life that we live and how you are renewing us day by day. And you're giving us a new rewritten story because of your faithfulness and your presence. So, Father, today, whether it be in the organized ministry that we do as a body of believers here at SCN, or we find ourselves in the coming and going of going to school and going to work and interacting with our families, God, would you give us a heart, a desire, a burning unction within us, Lord God, to see the wonder around us, the potential of the wonder around us, that we don't just get to watch it happen, but we get to participate in it as well. Father, would you mold our hearts like yours and allow us to participate you in that wonderful work. Father, we love you so very much, and we are grateful for the privilege of being able to praise you today. And all God's people said, amen, amen. I'm going to invite you to be seated, and as you do, I'll draw your attention to the screen for this video.
My name is Claire. I am a senior at Selinsgrove High School, and I serve with the first to third graders. I got involved in serving because my mom asked me to help in the nursery one morning, and then after that, I kind of just started doing it like regularly, and then I started with the 2 to 3 year olds, and then I went to the first to third graders.
My name is Jake Rodkey. I'm a student at SU. I play football in Army ROTC, and I'm really glad to be a part of this church. The best part about serving for me is knowing that I get to be a part of a wonderful team worshiping the Lord. It's just so enjoyable for me to be a part of a strong Christian group that is just playing music together for the Lord when you break it down.
My name is Seth Martin. I'm 41 years old. I learned really quickly that this type of service, ministry, especially with the youth, it's a different type of serving. And it's a serving that I feel like I get more out of it than what I put in, which I don't know that that's possible, but it seems like that's the way it works.
I'm Lisa Benner. I'm 58, and so every day I try to align myself with the heart of God. And wherever I'm serving that day, whether it's at church, whether it's within my family, within the community, I try to bring that heart of Jesus with me wherever I go. And I just pray that that shines through.
Hi, I'm Pat Troutman. I live in Freeburg, Pennsylvania, and I am 77 years old, soon to be 78. I serve because I want to please him. I serve because there's so many coming in our doors that have a story to tell. And we never know what that story is. It could be a grief story. It could be a story of being very lonely, looking for company. We need to find out what their story is. We need to greet them with love of Christ. And I just try to do that in every way that I can. I always pray before we enter the church. I pray that the Holy Spirit will anoint each one that enters the building, from the smallest baby to the oldest adult. I can't say enough about serving because so many people have asked me through the years, and I know we always say, I need to pray about that. But I came to recognize the fact that We do need to pray about it because we want the Lord, His will in our life. However, you know what's even more? The person that asks you to serve has probably already prayed for you to serve, and the Lord has given them a go-ahead. So when somebody asks you to serve, please look at it as being a part of a church family, serving the Lord, and say yes to them.
I serve at SCN because I know without a doubt, more than anything I've ever known, this is exactly where God wants me to be. And it feels really good to not be wandering around in the dark, wondering what your purpose is and why you have this platform and whether or not you're using it the way that you're supposed to. And I know that I'm where I'm supposed to be. And I lived a long time not knowing that, what my purpose was. And I don't wonder that anymore. And I love it. And I'm not going to stop anytime soon.
I serve at SCN because I feel like I need to use my gifts and talents that the Lord has given me for Him and His glory.
But the real reason that I serve is because God first loved me. And I just think that it's my faith and my wanting to serve because He is my Lord and my Savior. And I'm just so thankful for that. And I just serve wherever I can because I know that it's blessing the Lord and I hope it's blessing others.
I serve at SCN because I love loving on God's children.
I serve at SCN because I want to share the heart of God. And wherever I go and however I serve, I want to bring the heart of God with me so that His heart shines through me in whatever I do.
So this morning, you've certainly caught wind of a theme that we've woven through the service today with serving. And we do that for a few different reasons. First and foremost, let me say, our heart is we want to say thank you. Our heart is we want to say thank you because many of you do serve in the life of our church and in a church that's growing and a church that continually finds new ministries and new ways to engage with one another as well as within our community. It takes a lot of hands to be able to accomplish the work that God is calling us into. And many of you are serving in an area or in multiple areas to help us to be the church that God's calling us to be. That being said, because we are a growing church, because we are a church that continues to move forward and we're not afraid to step in faith with new opportunities and new ministries, the need is always growing for more to be involved and to plug in and to be a part of what God is doing here in and through us here as a church. You know, you've heard us start to talk about recently the idea of adding services, and we're talking about adding ministries, significant ministries over the course of this next year. And all of those things require God's people to do something. And what I love about that is we don't need everyone to do everything, but we do need everyone to do something. And we are just putting the opportunity in front of you to pray about saying yes. I love Pat's language about the idea that, you know, when somebody asks you to serve, you can have confidence that God's already in it because they've already prayed for you and God's given them the go-ahead. So the reality is if you say no, you're telling God no, and I'll leave that between you and Him. But in seriousness, right, serving is an opportunity for us to just flesh out our worship, right, and our praise and our acknowledgement of being a part of that wonder that we've been praying about and thinking about together this morning. When you came in this morning, no doubt you saw something a little different here in our sanctuary as we have this large serving wall in the back of the sanctuary with lots of cards and different things on that. There's about probably 10 to 12 different ministries, and that certainly isn't anywhere near exhaustive, but there are about 10 to 12 areas of ministry that are easy ways to plug in with varying levels of commitment, many of which you can do on Sunday morning, which you already are participating in doing. It might require you coming a little bit earlier, staying a little bit later, attending one service for worship and serving in another hour for worship, but together, if everybody does something, I have no doubt we will cover and meet the needs of a growing church and growing ministry. And so here's what I want to ask you to do. Today and then over the next couple of weeks where you see this wall, I'd invite you to go back and take a look at it. And there's some longer, a little bit larger cards on there that are kind of descriptive of some of those ministry areas. And then there's a bunch of these individual cards that correspond with that information. And what I'd like you to do is consider saying yes to an area of ministry that will help us move the needle forward as we prepare for some of this new work of ministry that God is doing for us. You'll notice that these cards are perforated, right? The top section is kind of just gives you a little bit of information so you can take that home and continue to pray about it and remember that you said yes. And the bottom half just gives us your basic contact information to make sure that we have it, and then we can follow up with you and give you a little more information. What I will tell you is by doing this, by signing this up, you're not signing your life away, right? You're not committing to anything really other than to say, I'm willing to say yes to invite somebody from the church to talk to me about serving in this particular area. And we will follow up with you, and we will try to help you plug into an area that fits you and fits the needs of the church so we can continue to do ministry. And so there's a lot of information back there. Please don't just rush past it. Pause, take a look, read through, and pray about saying yes to where God might have you participate in the life of the church at some level. Okay? Thank you. Pastor Jacob.
Amen. I'll never forget when I was 17, I was attending a youth group and being asked to serve for the first time. And I liked how Pat said in that part of the video where she said, being asked to serve is because you're part of the family. And it's a way to continue to grow together. So yeah, I agree. Please pray over that and please jump in with us. And so before we jump into the word this morning, I want you to do me a favor. We're going to pray for a local church in our community, Grove Community Church. So a great friend of mine, his name's Chapin Jones. He's the planting pastor of this church. They planted last year about this same time. And he sent me a text message this week, and he said, hey, Jacob, we want to know how we can pray for your church this Sunday. And I thought that was really cool, that another church in our community is praying for us this morning. And so I gave him a request, a way that they could pray for us, and then I said, hey, how can we pray for you? And he gave me this prayer request for them. They're a new church, a young church, and looking for people that can help them make disciples, looking for leaders that can help shepherd their church. And so not just praying that God would bring people there, but praying that God would stir the people that are there and disciple them. So do me a favor. Can we pray for this church this morning? Is that okay? You guys are really quiet today. So if you're okay with that, let's just put our hands in the air together, and we're going to pray for Grove Community Church this morning. Father God, we thank you for the privilege that it is to minister alongside fellow Christians, our brothers and sisters in you, Jesus, the fellow churches that we get to have in our community, that we are not a lone island in the mission field of the Susquehanna Valley, that there are many, many other churches that we get to work alongside, and this one in particular, Grove Community Church, that you called into existence last year. God, we are so grateful that you are growing the work of your kingdom in our community. And God, we pray for them this morning that you would continue to grow their church. And numerically, great, but also inwardly, God, that you would continue to disciple their people, continue to raise up leaders, bring leaders from outside if you need to, Lord, but continue the work of your ministry that's happening at Grove Community Church. God, I also just want to pray a special prayer for Chapin and his family, and that you would continue to multiply his energy and efforts. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, thank you for doing that with me. So as we jump in this morning, how's your week been? Has it been weird? Is your phone been eerily quiet this week? All the political text messages that have gone away and the pollsters and the mailbox is empty, right? It's like you wonder if the mail is broken or something. And I tell you what, I'm from Oklahoma, and we're not really considered a battleground state in Oklahoma. And I kind of miss that. I kind of miss living in a already decided state. But it's been crazy this week. And maybe you're on the side of it that maybe it's been a great week. Maybe you've been celebrating. Maybe you're really happy. Maybe you're on the side of it that it's been very depressing. It's been frustrating. Maybe you're somewhere in between. I'll tell you, for me, the hardest part of this week has not necessarily been the politics of it all. It's been the statements that I've seen people make. It's been the statements of, if you voted for this particular person, I don't want you in my life anymore. And those are real statements. People mean that. And it's sad to me how polarized, I mean, that's truly the sign of how polarized our country has become, right? Because people are saying, I don't want you in my life anymore if you don't agree with this portion of it. And it's rough and it's hard. And our pastor started this series last week called Divided We Stand, and I think that's got to be the perfect emphasis for this season, because you can't force unity. We could just pretend to be united and just put on a face, and that might work for a season, but it's not true, is it? And yet, there's got to be a way to still stand together. There's got to be a way to still have unity, even in the midst of the disagreement. We're going to ask ourselves the question this morning, is it more important to be right, or is it more important to speak truth, to teach truth? We're going to be in Romans chapter 2 together, and Romans chapter 2 is a thick chapter. There's a lot of context in it. There's a lot of layer of conversation that we're not privy to, that you have to do the extra study, you have to do the extra research, you have to connect the dots of the whole book of Romans 4. We're not going to peel all of that away this morning. We're going to really just focus on one particular verse today, and we're going to ask ourselves that hard question. Would we rather be known for being right, or would we rather be known for the truth? Why don't you pray with me, and we'll jump into his word to that together. Jesus, I'm so grateful for your presence. And I know I say it all the time, and I pray it all the time, and I think I pray it every single time that I do pray, but how could we move forward without your presence? How could we navigate the divide without your presence? How could we have hard and difficult conversations without your presence? How could we take a deep look at ourselves without you being present with us? And that's what we need. Not to spend the time trying to prove somebody wrong, to spend the time reflecting, to spend the time letting you bring truth. God, I pray that you'd be part of our conversation this morning. That through your word, we could see you clearer. We could know you deeper. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, I'll just warn you, the scripture that we're going to look at is kind of rough, and you might have a tendency, like me, to just kind of glaze past it, to think, well, this is for somebody else, this isn't really for me, but I want you to lean in this morning and not hear this as talking about somebody else, but hear this as a question for ourselves. Go ahead. God's name is being blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. And it's a statement that Paul is making to the church in Rome. And like I said, there's a lot of layers to this conversation. There's a lot of context that we don't have time to flesh out, but I think I can kind of show you what's happening and what the problem is. If you can't see this very clearly, I've got two jars here that are broken. And I wrapped them in tape and smashed them with a hammer, and I think it turned out pretty cool. But they're broken. And how oftentimes, you tell me if you can relate to this, when you're in conflict with somebody, it ends up looking like two broken jars just arguing as to who is more broken. You know, trying to prove who is more right, who is more wrong. And that's what's happening in the church in Rome. You see, the church in Rome is made up of two groups. You've got a Jewish group that they've grown up knowing the Old Testament scriptures. They've grown up knowing the law. They've followed the traditions. They've followed the commandments. And yet they've now come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah. And they're trying to live their life that way. You've got another group of people that are called the Gentiles, which is really just the Bible word for somebody that's not a Jew. So if you weren't raised Jewish, then you are with me in the fact that we are Gentiles. And this group of people in Rome, they didn't have the background, they didn't have all the knowledge. What they had was they came to believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. and they're trying to figure it out. And they're listening to the teachings of the apostles, and they're trying to grow in their faith. And there's conflict between these two groups. And you might think, well, that's silly. Why would there be conflict between these two groups? Well, let me kind of frame it into a perspective you might be able to understand. So here over here, the Jews, you know, if you were a Jew in Rome, you might be saying to the Gentiles, you guys are broken. You're missing all these pieces that are so vitally important. You know, you have no idea how to even worship God unless you study and learn and memorize the law. You're not supposed to eat meat that way. You're not supposed to work on the Sabbath. And if you're going to be a follower of Jesus, you have to be circumcised. And if you were a Gentile, you might say something back like, that doesn't make any sense. That clearly didn't work for you. Why would I impose on myself some old archaic law that isn't relevant anymore? You're not following the leading of the Holy Spirit. How could you possibly claim to be a follower of Jesus? And the other side might say something back like, who are you to challenge me? You need to change your perspective. You have no perspective of the entirety of who God is and how he's worked with his people. I don't know that we're really part of the same church after all. And the other side might say something back like, yeah, I think you're right. In fact, I don't know that I want people to think that we go to the same church or we're a part of the same group. So it'd be better for you to just stay over there and not be part of us over here. And that's an oversimplified, dramatized version. One of those words was right in there. Of the conflict. And where the content of that argument might not mean much to us today, I bet you the context of it does. Because how oftentimes do you see a broken jar trying to argue with another broken jar of which one is more broken? Which one is more right or wrong? Maybe it doesn't look like this today. Maybe it looks something more like this. You know, how could you possibly think that you're a Christian and vote for somebody like that? How could you possibly think that you're following and worshiping Jesus and yet think that that person should be leading our country? Are you joking? Do you have any idea how much destruction your party has caused? And how could you possibly think that you could be a believer in Jesus and support some of the things that they do and talk about? I don't know that I want to be friends with you anymore. Why don't you just delete my contact? And again, maybe a overdramatized, simplified version, but maybe you can relate to some of those conversations. Maybe like me, you've seen it time and time again in the comment sections. Maybe you're seeing it in your workplace. Maybe you're seeing it in your home or in family relationships or close relationships. And the problem, well, I'll say part of the problem is certainly the conflict, but that's not really the worst part. The worst part is when one of those people, and probably both of those people, kind of go and they find their group. They find their team. They find their people that agree with them, and they start only saying the negative things about this other person. And they say, yeah, I mean, I can't believe this, and you won't believe, you know, they said this to me, and they were, blah, blah, blah. And the person they're talking to says back to them, oh, yeah, they're terrible, you're right, and you know, they probably believe this, too, and oh, yeah, they probably do believe that, too, and they're just, man, they're not who I ever thought they were, and they've got to be this terrible person. And pretty soon, what happens is they're no longer talking about the person or what was even said. They're talking about this demonized version of them. The worst possible interpretation of who this person could be. That's what it looks like to become polarized. Because it doesn't bring you back together. It drives a permanent wedge apart. If you haven't been paying attention to the national news cycle for the last 20 years, we've been watching that happen, haven't we? The reality, though, is, again, the real problem is not just on the political scale. I liked how our pastor in our last series, he talked about the struggle sometimes is not over the big stuff, it's about who does the dishes. And maybe it looks more like this. you're never here anymore. You don't help anymore. We don't talk anymore. You don't ask me any questions. You just drift in and out of here like I'm supposed to be supportive and take care of you and do all this stuff, but you don't ever invest in me, and you don't listen to me talk, and I don't think this is working anymore. Why would I listen to you talk? Every time you talk to me, you bicker and nag me about what I don't do, or when I do things, how I did it wrong, and of course I'm kind of avoiding you, because this is what every conversation that we have looks like, and I'm not working so much because I like it. I'm working so much because that's when they tell me I have to work, and I'm trying to provide for our family, and I don't understand why you can't appreciate that. And I agree. I don't think this is working. And again, the worst part is not just that. The worst part is when one or both of those people go find their team. Yeah, he is a dirtbag. Yeah, she is a nag. Yeah, I don't know why you ever married them, or why you've ever been friends with them, or. And it gets worse, and it gets louder, and the hurt gets deeper, and the cracks get worse. And I don't know about you, but I've never seen two glass jars arguing about who is more broken actually come to reconciliation through their argument. Something I always try to tell married couples, anytime that I can, really, because it's excellent advice that we got years ago. Do not let people speak into your marriage that will polarize you like this. If you go to somebody and complain about your spouse, which, hey, sometimes you have to, it's hard. If you go to somebody and complain about your spouse and they agree with you, you need to walk out of the room. Because they're not pushing you back together. They're polarizing you apart. You end up talking about the demonized version of the person that you love instead of who they actually are. You've got to have people in your life that will say, I hear you, but were you really listening? Did you really hear him? It sounds like some of the things that she said might be true. What do you think about that? I think you should pray about it. I think you should take some time and go back and try to have that conversation again, where you can listen instead of talk. That's the friends that you need, that you need to give access to your relationship. But it's hard. It's hard when we're so unwilling to recognize our own brokenness and our own flaws and cracks that we end up committed to being right, no matter the cost. That's the rebuke that Paul is bringing to the church in Rome. That's what he's calling out in the church in Rome. That's what's happening. He's not rebuking them. The God's name is not being blasphemed because of wrong teachings or because of bad theology. God's name is being blasphemed because of the squabbling, because of the bickering, because of the argument on who is more broken. And the worst part is the church in Rome is actually choosing to be known by that. You know, the Jews, they want to be known as the true followers of God. And the Gentiles want to be known as the Spirit-led Christians. And don't go talk to them. Don't go be part of their group, because they don't know what they're talking about. Look how broken they are. And it's ironic to me, when you look at how Christ calls us to be known. It's out of John chapter 13. Tell me if you've read this before. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you voted for this particular political party. I'll let you decide which one. By this, everyone will know that you're my disciples if you win an argument. By this, everyone will know you're my disciples if you love one another. And he's talking to his disciples. He's not talking to a crowd. He's not talking to a generic group of people. He's talking to literally the church as it existed in that time. And he's not saying, if you love the homeless, which I've always found to be incredibly fascinating. He's not saying if you love tax collectors. He's not saying if you love prostitutes. He's not saying if you love the lost, they're going to know. He's saying if you love one another. Well, why? Because the world is used to this. Two broken jars trying to be right. They're not used to a group of people that can love each other through the division, through the disagreements, through the pain. You compare that to the rebuke that Paul is giving, and this is a great opportunity for me to ask you a plural or ambiguous question. You know, how do you think our nation fits into this comparison? Man, that feels so much more comfy because we're talking about them. We're talking about somebody else. Now, how do you think our state fits into this? How do you think Philadelphia or Pittsburgh fits into this? How do you think Susquehanna Valley? But those kind of questions aren't actually helpful when it comes to this. Where do you fit into this? Where do I fit? Are we known by our love for one another, or are we known for our commitment to being right? What have your social media comments looked like this week? What are you known for? What have your conversations looked like this week? What are you known for? If somebody wants to complain about something, are you somebody that they think about to come get in their camp to agree with them? Or are you somebody that's going to speak truth to push them back? Paul says that God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you, and he's using that word blasphemed, and that's kind of a big, scary, I think, word in the Christian church a lot. We don't often really know what it means, and sure, it does mean to slander, it does mean to lie, it does mean to deceive, it does mean those things, but it also means to speak lightly of. It also means to be sluggish, slow, or refuse to acknowledge what's good. So when you're blaspheming the name of God, it's not just because you're lying about it, it's because maybe you're slow to acknowledge that he is good. Maybe you're slow to acknowledge the love that he has, the mission that he has, his commitment to his people. If somebody in my life, if I am causing somebody in my life to blaspheme the name of God, maybe it's because of the way I'm living my life and what they're seeing in it. Maybe they're not seeing the restoration that he brings. Maybe they're seeing a broken jar trying to prove that he's right over somebody else. And it's causing them to not want to really listen to this message of the gospel. Why would they if it looks the same? Paul is rebuking them because they're not preaching the truth. And let me read for you what I think this kind of sums up what he's talking about. It's Romans chapter 3. And he says, what shall we conclude then? Do we have any advantage? Not at all. For we've already made the charge that the Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the same power of sin. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And all are justified freely by his grace that comes through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. Both sides are broken. I don't know about you, there's a lot of healing and freedom that comes with the acknowledgement that I am just as broken as the person I'm arguing against. I don't have to be right. I can let go of that. What's interesting about that, too, is, you know, while we argue about who is more right, the one that is not broken, the one that is solid, he actually models perfectly for us what humility looks like in relationships. Read this with me out of Philippians. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus, as Christ Jesus. And I'll tell you, if there's a part that you might want to close your ears for, this would be it. Because it's a hard call. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used as for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in the appearance of man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. So the only one that truly is not broken broke himself. Not so that he could have the advantage over somebody else, so that he could bring healing and redemption to somebody else. So he could bring the restoration that is really what is needed. That's the truth that Paul is calling the Roman church toward. Both of you are broken. So be united in the need for restoration with Jesus. Stop trying to be right. Start trying to love each other. Now, like I said before, I don't think the question that a lot of people in our country are asking right now is, how do we come back together? I think the question people are asking is, do we want to come back together? Do we want to try to bring unity? Or do we want to be comfortable on our teams? Where do you fall in that? Because we can't answer a question for a country or for a nation of people, but we can answer that question for us. Where do you fall in that? What do you want to be known for? We're going to use this next time as a response time. Pastor Josh is going to come, and he's going to lead us in a song. And you're welcome to sing the song. Sure. I would ask that you would use this intentionally to reflect on three things. The first one, I want to challenge you to consider that you might need to repent. For yourself or on behalf of another. You know, if you're somebody that you have made a dramatic statement this week of people that you don't want to be part of your life anymore, I think you need to repent. If you're somebody that you have mocked or ridiculed or created greater division this week in your comments or in your conversations, I think you need to repent. If you're somebody, some people in here are hearing me say today that we're not allowed to call people out on their sin. That's not true. But what's your motivation? If your motivation for pointing out somebody else's brokenness is to make you feel better, I think you need to repent. Take heart in knowing that if you come forward to the altar to repent, and you're worried that somebody in the room is going to judge you for that, guess what? They really should be up here with you. We have an altar. We have a lot of, nobody likes to sit in the front row. That's fine. Gives us lots of room. If you need to repent this morning, I want to invite you to come forward and kneel. Take that risk. Let that be a statement for you that you're going to be obedient to Jesus in that. We're going to do it together. I'm going to be down here too, not just to pray for people that are more broken than me, but because I need to repent. Maybe you're somebody that you have nothing to repent of. Hey, praise the Lord. I'm so glad you're here. Not because you're going to lloyd it over the top of us, but because you know what brokenness looks like, don't you? And you know the forgiveness that God has brought into your life. And we need you to come forward and pray, not just for the rest of us, but pray for people in your life that might need to repent. Not just for the political stuff either. If you're holding a resentment against somebody, and I would be willing to bet that person's face popped into your mind, you might need to repent. To let that go. To put the weight down. I'm also going to ask, after you repent, and you have to do it in order, that you would intercede. How are we going to be part of God bringing healing to a broken nation if we're not willing to repent of our own brokenness? So come and intercede. Come and pray, not just for the unity, but for the healing of our nation. Maybe you're like me, I have a tendency when I start to pray for people that have hurt me or frustrated me, I start to pray that God would change them. And what he typically does is not go and lord it over them and parade them around of how wrong they are. What he typically does is put me in a situation where I can listen, where I can hear their perspective. Pray for that. I'm going to ask that you would pray intentionally for an opportunity this week to love somebody. That's going to be the hard one, because not everybody else is in this room. Not everybody else is being convicted by God to bring healing to our relationships. Some of those people, you're going to go try to offer an olive branch to them, and they're going to shove it down your throat. It hurts. But who else is going to do it? Paul is rebuking the church in Rome because they look just like the rest of the world. And he's calling us to look different. He's calling us to model the restoration and healing that he brings. Not to lord it over people, so that they can see the opportunity for it too. So, Pastor Josh is going to lead us. Why don't you come?
Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified, altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry from north to south and east to west. We'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky, and from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Yeah.
No, I won't bow to idols. I'll stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. And I won't be formed by feelings. I hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. When I join you in your sufferings, I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, oh, my heart will still be singing. My song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let your praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, be magnified from the altar of my life. Would you be magnified in me?
Jesus, that you would bring restoration. That you would be present. In the midst of the squabbling, in the midst of the hurt, in the midst of all the times that I've put somebody down so that I could win, so that I could feel some sense of reassurance or affirmation, or that you would keep pressing, that you would keep convicting, that you would highlight my brokenness, that you wouldn't let me turn from it, that you would call me to repent, not so you could rub my face in how good you are, so that you can show me what healing looks like. That you can show me how to love people the way you love. How to love my church the way that you love. How to love my neighbor the way that you love. How to love the stranger the way that you love. How to love the Democrat the way that you love. How to love the Republican the way that you love. That you could model healing in our nation when it feels like we've never been more divided. And you would choose to do that through your church. Lord, we want to intercede, not praying that you would just change the mind of everybody we don't like and disagree with, but praying that you would give us opportunity to listen, to show them your truth, to show them your love, not to change our perspective, not to change our commitment to you, not to change what you've shown us as truth, but to listen. That when the rest of the world just expects two broken jars to keep arguing, that we could be the people that would model what true healing and unity can look like. Lord, I pray against division that we've allowed into our church body, gossip that we allow, that you would convict that you would call us to repent of that we would be unified. Think about another thing that Pat Troutman said. From the youngest to the oldest, to be anointed by your Spirit, not just in this place, but to go. And I pray, Lord, that this week as we go, you would give us opportunity to love other people. You'd give us opportunity to model compassion, to model empathy, to model humility, to not step into arguments because we think we have an upper hand, but step into a conversation to listen. To model the restoration that you want to bring. Lord, I thank you. And I praise you for your presence with us here this morning. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you.